Now let's talk about reality checks. How do you know that your diff-and-diff model satisfies the parallel trend assumption and is giving you an unbiased estimate of the effect of the policy or treatment that you're studying? Well, if you have enough data, pre-treatment, you can graph the outcome variable for the treatment group and control group and see if they track each other. That is, we can use pre-treatment data to see whether the parallel trends assumption holds. This test is usually done informally by presenting the graph and discussing how well the two groups track each other. Another way to test the validity of the model is to look for an effect where there has not been any treatment. This type of test is usually referred to as a placebo test. The idea is this: if the trends are not parallel, then we may find a spurious treatment effect when in fact there's been no treatment given. So if we run a fake diff and diff with the same data and we find a spurious effect, then we are not very confident that our actual diff and diff is capturing a real treatment effect. Another way to say this is that if the situation is suitable for our technique to work properly, we should not be finding a significant effect from non-existent treatment. Okay, we've explained the basic logic of diff and diff, described how to implement the technique both in a raw form and by regression. We've discussed the importance of parallel trends and how to test for them. Let's conclude this section by talking about a few more examples of research using the diff and diff technique. As our textbook mentions, the first difference in difference project was done in the 1850s by Dr. John Snow in England. He wanted to show that the disease cholera came from drinking contaminated water. In London, water was supplied by two companies, both of which initially drew it right out of the Thames, right as the river passed through the middle of London. Needless to say, that was some nasty polluted water. A lot of raw sewage was being dumped into the river in this highly populated area. However, in 1852, one of the companies started sourcing their water from a spot upstream from London. The doctor compared death rates in districts served by the two water companies before and after the one company started using cleaner water, and found that cleaner water greatly lowered mortality from cholera. A more up-to-date example can be found in a 2016 National Bureau of Economic Research working paper by two economists, Justin Pierce and Peter Schott. They compare counties with manufacturing jobs vulnerable to competition with China to counties whose manufacturing is less vulnerable before and after the U.S. significantly opened up trade with China in October 2000. Using diff and diff, they found that opening trade led to a significant increase in suicides among white males in the counties more vulnerable to Chinese competition. Finally, I also want to mention a slightly different type of diff and diff analysis that comes from my own research. In a 2016 paper published in Economic Inquiry, me, Daniel Hicks, and Weitzi Wan studied whether gender imbalance in China created incentives for unmarried men to undertake conspicuous consumption to attract mates. You know, like peacocks. We compared the difference in spending on automobiles between married and unmarried men in both districts where the gender ratio was relatively equal and districts where the gender ratio was highly skewed towards more men. We found that unmarried men spent significantly more on cars relative to married men in the highly unbalanced districts compared to the balanced ones. So here, even though there was no before and after, we were able to use a classic diff and diff technique. Here, the treated control group is unmarried men and the control group is married men. Instead of happening across time, though, the treatment happens across geographic space. We don't observe the treated group before and after treatment. Instead, we observe them at the same time, but in places where the treatment is and isn't happening. Some are in gender balance districts, and some in districts with too many men, where competition for females is extreme. Okay then, let's wrap up. We know it is generally going to be wrong to estimate a treatment effect by comparing outcomes between the treated and control groups, unless treatment was randomly assigned. But comparing the differences between the treated and controls before and after treatment eliminates the influence of any time-invariant confounding variables, and if nothing else is causing the difference between the groups to change, this technique, which we call diff and diff, can give us an unbiased estimate of the effect of the policy or treatment we are studying. As I look around the room, I see no one has any questions. I guess that means I knocked this lecture out of the park. I'll see you soon to talk about our next technique, propensity score matching.